So right now, without further ado, I'm going to introduce these two gentlemen right here. We have Matt Samways and Andrew Ward. They're going to give you a little bit of background about, you know, where they come from, what they've done, but they're going to talk about what does it mean for smart integration. So I'm going to hand it over to these guys.
Thanks, Walt. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this short talk about BIM. What does it mean for smart integration? It's going to be a sort of high-level overview of what BIM is, where it came from, what it looks like, and how it may fit in with your line of business. So about myself and my colleague here, my name's Matt Samways. I'm the BIM Management Director for AIMIS Solutions Limited, set up last year in April 2016. We look at helping all disciplines within the AEC industry in adapting to new digital technologies and getting into the BIM arena. I've got a master's degree in BIM management last year, the first postgraduate qualification available in the UK, member of the Institute of Engineering Technology. And a little fun fact about me, I used to live in Thailand as a scuba diving instructor, which was a nice life. But as you're about to see, what I'm doing now is loads better than diving in Thailand. So that's me. I'll hand you over to my colleague.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name's Andrew Ward. I'm one of the directors at Sound & Vision. We're based in North London, been going about 10 years now. We focus on the high-end residential market, and we use KNX and Control 4 to deliver our projects predominantly. My fun fact, as you'll see, also was I also lived and worked in Thailand as a scuba diving instructor, so we have got some sort of connection here outside of work. And part of the reason that I'm here is to see if we can make a connection or bring smart home technology into the BIM world and see how that's going to look. So I'll pass you over to Matt.
Thanks, Andy. So as you can gather, we're friends from a past, and our two businesses have joined together to give this presentation using the knowledge from both of us. So the agenda for the talk, we'll start off with an overview of BIM, what it is and where it came from. We'll have a look at some of the benefits that the construction industry has got since it came out a few years ago. Then we'll look at BIM for smart technologies, have a look about what it might look like in the future, and then finish off with a conclusion and a question time. So to begin with, an overview of BIM, a bit of a definition that I've put together when doing these slides. So it's a set of processes enabled by technology to create a full set of information, models, or data sets about a built asset. So it's about having everything in a digital space. It's formed of graphical and non-graphical information, so that's your drawings, your models, your schedules and specifications, and holding all of that information in a single source of truth, what we call a common data environment, so everybody has access to it. The processes follow the life of a project from brief all the way through to demolition or reuse, where information about the asset builds over time, making clients or allowing clients to make better informed decisions about the delivery of their projects into facilities maintenance. It's aimed at increasing efficiencies across the board, reducing waste, waste being a very big problem in the construction industry through wasted resource, money, materials. So it reduces this by having a much more collaborative effort across the whole supply chain. So everybody has their play to part. Part to play from client all the way through to facilities managers. It was mandated on all UK government projects from April 2016, and we've seen an increase in presence in the private sector with some of the larger developers in and around London also requiring BIM. And this diagram just on here that you can sort of see, this comes out of one of the standards that defines level 2 BIM, just showing that as the project life cycle goes from brief all the way through to in use. This is the information growing over time, the non-graphical, the graphical, and the documentation over on the right-hand side into asset management. This is one of my favourite quotes when I deliver a BIM talk. So architectural information is invariably inaccurate, ambiguous, and incorrect. A lot of people agree with me when I come out with that, but it's not just architectural information, it's all information across the construction industry. And this came out of an RICS meeting in 1910. So we've known about bad information for over 100 years. And it's only about 6 or 7 years ago that the government decided to do something about it. And that's sort of where BIM came from. So in a traditional form of BIM project, We would have coordination of information across the designers using two-dimensional drawings overlaid one on top of the other, trying to coordinate the different designers' information and the supply chain after that. So there's a lot of eye work, hand drawings or CAD drawings and stuff, and they will all be filed away somewhere in a folder for people to use on the project. And then over the life of the project, we get loads of this stuff, paper coming out, schedules, programs, contractual information, specifications, that builds up over the life and again will be filed away somewhere in a folder. The key here being that it's completely disconnected to those drawings that we saw before. It's not connected information. And this is what we tend to hand over at the end of a project, the facilities maintenance information, bunches of paper locked away in a basement somewhere, getting wet, eaten by rats. Not very structured. Imagine trying to service that facility if something needs replacing. How are you going to find that information? When it gets a bit too wet, we stick it in boxes, sometimes pretty boxes, but that's about as far as it gets, and it gets filed away, also disconnected with the rest of the information on that project. So essentially, we've got a lot of poor coordination, unstructured information, loads of hard copies of paper, and almost impossible to locate that important information that has been built up over the life of a project. Essentially, lots of waste. So this is what BIM's trying to do. It's trying to reduce that waste by increasing efficiencies, structuring our information, and sharing it in a collaborative environment. Okay, so now we're going to have a quick look to see what that looks like in a digital world. So this is the digital version. What we're looking at here is a structural model from the structural engineers from a large hospital and hotel. And they have modelled their responsibility, the structural elements. Like I said earlier, everybody has their part to play. So the other designers would create models for their own information, which we would then import into the other models to create what we call a federated model. So we're selecting the mechanical and electrical services model here, and it's going to drop into place. You can just see it bring it in there. It's been modelled in the same coordinates, so it knows where to go when we bring it in. We then can bring in some more information from the architect. So they've modelled a number of elements, the facade, the core, the equipment that goes in the hospital and the hotels, and we would bring those models in as well. When we bring it in and federate it like this, the software can then carry out automated clash detection, so we've got much better coordination than looking at the 2D plans all the time. And as this comes in, you get a holistic view of the project. It all drops in, and all the different model files are located in the selection inspector at the side here, and we can select each of those models individually, turn them off, turn them back on again if we want to have a look at a specific element of the project. So here we're going to isolate the equipment so that you can see the equipment that's been brought into this project. And it just goes into the hospital area where you can see all of the hospital equipment, the beds and so on and so forth. This is a stage 3 design model. So all of this is generic components within that model. The idea being that as that project progresses, the supply chain, the people that are going to install the actual project products will replace the design elements with the installed elements. So at the end of that project, we end up with a nice coordinated model of installed equipment. And where we're trying to get to, if we can have all of that information and models here in this one space, a nice digital asset which holds all of the graphical modelled information as well as the information contained within the models. We want structured data so that we're not fighting around trying to find paper anymore. If it's structured and digital, then we can find the information much easier. And then what we'd like to be doing is attaching that to building management systems where we can actually use the BIM model to manage that facility and use sensory equipment, Internet of Things and everything to actually control the facilities management. So then how does it work with smart technologies? So that's a sort of large commercial installation. If you have any dealings with the commercial world, we're now going to bring it into a slightly smaller residential world. Where we're looking at a project that Andy did actually deliver as a live project. And what we've done, because we don't want to have a presentation about something without relating it to you guys, we've tried to demonstrate this in a case study of taking that project that was delivered traditionally and then putting it into a BIM model to see what it would have looked like had it been done in BIM. So Andy's just going to introduce the project for you.
Thanks, Matt. Okay, so let's look at this in a home automation environment. So what we've done is we've taken a project called The Forge. It was something we delivered in a traditional fashion last year, so hundreds of drawings, crate loads of folders and stuff. But it's quite a modest project, about 60 circuits of lighting control, about 30 keypads, 12 zones of heating control, and a Gira visualization server sat on top as the top layer of control. And what Matt's going to do in the following slides is he's going to give us an example of adding some lighting fittings to our 2D drawings, configuring that as a lighting circuit, and then attaching that to a dimmer and progressing on and drawing up a load schedule and showing us how to edit the load schedule. And then beyond that, we'll see how the 3D model looks at the end once this thing's been configured.
Great, thank you, Andy. So the first thing we're going to look at here is adding that lighting circuit. So this is the ground floor ceiling plan. We need to put some lights into this living area here. So we would go to our systems tab, go to the lighting fixtures to pick a fixture. We then choose which type of fitting it's going to be from our library. So in this instance, we're going to create a circular ceiling light. We then tell it where to put it. So we're going to place it on the ceiling face. So it knows where to place these objects. We don't have to add any height information or anything like that. It knows that it's putting it in the ceiling, so we just drop them in like so. And then we need to create that as a circuit. So we can select one of those fittings, and then we can point to the power button up here. This allows us to then link that element back to a panel. So we're going to choose the panel AM1 on the drop down here, and when we build the circuit, it will allocate it to circuit number one. By clicking on the edit circuit, we then just need to select the other light fittings that are going to be included in that circuit. And then once that's finished, we just click OK. And then when we select one of those fittings again and go over to the electrical tab, it will then illustrate that circuit with the lines linking the different elements to that circuit, and we can see the information along the top about which panel it belongs to and which dimmer it is attached to. And then over in the systems browser, we can see that data in a textural form. So it breaks it down in here and it's connected. If we select this light fitting, and then it'll zoom in, and we can see that the light fitting number one there is at the panel AM1. It's circuit number one. And if you expand that, it will also show you the different ceiling lights attached to that circuit. And I think this is one of the things that interested Andy when we started putting this together a couple of months ago, to have that data connected. If you want to say a little bit about that, Andy.
So what this effectively said for me was that if we had a common data environment, one place where everyone involved with this light circuit was working, making amendments and making changes, we'd have a collaboration there between the stakeholders. And in my experience on several projects, I've got a set of drawings, the lighting designer is supplying some drawings on maybe a load schedule, and maybe the electricians are working from something they've had 4 months ago. And what this gives us all is one point of reference. And as the circuit is configured, we can see the assignments to a dimmer. And as we move further on, Matt's going to bring in a load schedule shortly. But we can also see how the 3D model looks now that another circuit has been added. And what that means to me, or what I'd like to see, is our panel. This is an example of our KNX panels where we have our dimmers. And inside that panel, we can open it up. And if I drill down into the software, I can locate the circuit that's just been added. And so it's a dynamic process in that by dropping the lights in here, the system browser is updated and the 3D model is also updated.
Great, thanks, Andy. So that's the data in there connected to the circuits that you can see. We can also extract that information in schedules very quickly, very accurately, which I'm going to show you in this next little clip here. So if we go to our schedule button, we can choose what type of schedule we want. It could be doors, windows, walls, but obviously in this case, we're going to choose a lighting fixtures schedule. It then allows us to choose which parameters we want to be included in the schedule. So family and type will tell us what type of fixture it is. We can extract the circuit number, the panel, the luminous flux intensity, and also the electrical data. So just as an example, you can choose whatever you need, click OK, and it gets automatically generated from the information contained within the model. So you can see the type of fitting, circuit, board, and electrical data. That can all be exported out into Excel quite easily. It's all very dynamic as well. So I'm going to show you the dynamics now. There's only one of everything in a model. So if you change it in one view, it will automatically update in other views. So here we've got the schedule on the left. We've got the plan of the model on the right. If we select one of those lighting fittings and decide we want to change the type, we come up and we change the type in the same place where we picked it in the first instance. And as that changes, the schedule automatically updates immediately with that change. And likewise, if we go on the drop down here and we want to change the different fitting, as you change it in the schedule, if you look on the right hand side there, the fixture will also update automatically. So it really eliminates a lot of the risk of human error when you're coordinating your information if it's all contained in the same place and everybody has access to it. Okay, we're going to go back to the other software earlier where I showed you about combining the models, and I'm going to show you how we can manage the data that comes out of these models within Navisworx. So back to the forge here, what we're going to do is use the data that's contained within the objects to locate them quickly in the model. So we're looking for all items where the property name contains the word lighting and it contains the word electrical. It's an OR condition, so it will look for both of those, and then it will automatically select them when we press find. So it's basing it on the data that's in the model. Once we click find all, it does select them all. We can't see it just at the moment. We're going to save the search set, because that saves the search criteria that we just entered, so we can use it later, and that search set will also get automatically updated. When we click on that search set, we can select everything else and then make it all transparent so we can see where those electrical fittings are within the property. So there we have it, transparent building. There's all the electrical fittings within there to see where everything is. We can then drill down a bit more detail within that data. If we want to search and find all of the elements on a particular circuit, we're looking for all elements associated to circuit number. Put it down a little bit. Circuit number equals one. We'll click on find. It will then find all of the items on circuit number one. Again, we can save that set. And if we want to give it some sort of color profiling, we can give it another color. In this instance, it's gone red. And then if you wanted to then do the same thing for all the other circuits, you can visualize what's associated to what circuit in any building at any given time. So hopefully providing some benefit with it, with your design processes when you're looking at getting this kit installed. Okay, so the benefits for you guys in the smart industry, I believe you're going to talk about these, Andy. Yep.
Okay, cool. So should we bring those up on screen? Let's have a look. So benefits to the smart home and home automation industry. The first one that I saw was that we've got a centrally managed data repository. So everyone's got all of their information in one place, which increases collaboration through people using process and technology to get together and get everything in one place. We've got all of our schedules in the same place. So you know, schedules, be that for loads, for TVs, for speakers. It's also for the windows and doors and the fabric of the building. So all of this information is super easy to access. Let's have a look. And through this information, we've got client transparency. So the client themselves can access the BIM model. And ultimately, through this efficiency, we're driving down the cost of delivering the project, which has always got to be a good thing. And last one here. So through all of this efficiency, we're creating less emails, less phone calls, and we're wasting a lot less time, meaning the client hopefully has got some more money to spend on his AV system.
Very good. Thanks, Andy. So there are a lot of benefits out there for you guys. The collaboration effort is a good one. So what does the future look like, or where we are now and how that's changing? So over the last couple of years, we've seen a lot more smart building technology manufacturers having BIM objects created for their products. When the government mandate came out in 2016, they could see this coming for the hospitals and schools. They're going to need to integrate BIM with those projects. But it also allows designers to select those objects and insert them in their early design models. So there's a good bit of marketing there as well. How they're used, well, currently a lot of these objects are used as generic placeholders. They're not actually connected up the same as I just showed you on the screen here by creating circuits and panels, which is really where the benefit is for you guys. So what we're trying to do is get people to start using the full functionality of this software and these processes. And that will hopefully lead on to linking the BIM model to the operation and maintenance through the Internet of Things for further integration to smart cities, which is on the agenda for the UK BIM task group, the Digital Built Britain Level 4 is talking about getting our built environment very much connected through the digital models with all of that data. So just to conclude then, BIM increases collaboration through people, process and technology, people being one of the most important there. It's sometimes difficult getting people to change how they do things, but we are making progress. It reduces waste through better project coordination and data management. So as we've been talking, Andy and myself, the whole collaboration and coordination effort is a lot more accurate and a lot easier to iron out. Each member of the supply chain has their part to play. So for integrators or yourselves with the smart technology, it would be your job to create the models for the stuff you're actually going to install, which would replace the architectural placeholders. But you can then use that, hopefully, into the operations and maintenance. As we said, it's mandated on government projects. So if you are involved in any of these larger commercial projects, you'll probably see it coming your way very soon. And then lastly, there is so much more to tell on this story. It's a huge subject. We've just covered the very sort of basics there to give you an overview. I hope you enjoyed it and found it a little bit interesting. And obviously, we are here to help you on your journey. If you need to get into this space, we can help with that. So thank you very much. If you've got any questions.
How effective has this been in identifying physical conflicts between subsystems?
Between subsystems?
So like HVAC and you have a light that goes in the same place.
And okay. Repeat the question.
Yeah.
So... how effective has BIM been in the UK and other places in identifying physical conflicts between subsystems?
Okay, identifying physical conflicts in the model, very effective. We use it predominantly for the M&E equipment in a building. So it has a built-in clash detection tool that you can use in Navisworks, which will clash all of the model geometry within that model and highlight where those clashes are. So you just need a little bit of careful management. So setting tolerances, how far does something need to overlap before it's termed as a clash? But in terms of identifying them, it's a little bit too effective sometimes when you're talking to the design team. But the coordination effort is a massive gain within the industry, because we always have on-site clashes between M&E equipment and the structure and the facade and stuff. So.
Is Navisworks its own program, or does that ride on top of like AutoCAD or something like that?
So Navisworks is its own software. It's an Autodesk software. It will take in file types from almost any other package. So it's a coordination software. We don't create the models in Navisworks. We would create the models in something like Revit or ArchiCAD or something like that. Navisworks is the software we use to bring them together in the same space and run the clash detection and the data verification, things like that.
Where does somebody go to learn more about this?
you can visit my website, aimis.co.uk. Failing that, there is a lot of information on the internet. Digital Built Britain is the government's. It's what they're how they're pushing BIM Level 2 and BIM Level 3 later on. So there's useful information on there and standards if you need to download standards. But like I say, always happy to take questions on the email or give me a phone call or whatever, and we can help you out.
Thanks. What's the availability? Sorry, the availability and consistency of object models from manufacturers, does that kind of restrict you? Because obviously if you've got one thing that's missing, it kind of compromises your ability to put everything in there. Are they generally available and consistency manufacturer to manufacturer? I've seen that being an issue in the past.
Yeah, so the objects that we put in, there are a lot out there. There's a couple of websites that allow them to be downloaded for free. They will make the objects for you if you are a manufacturer. Like I say, there's a lot out there. If the actual object that you want isn't there, you can create your own objects. So within the Revit space, you can create a dimmer if it's not already there available, and you can associate the necessary information about it. So if it's not there, you can still get it in there.
Having a look yesterday at a BIM object database for the objects, a lot of the big players have got a full suite of objects. So Crestron, Lutron, I think Honeywell are in there, Hike Vision cameras, Bose. There's a lot of big guys. There's a lot of HVAC objects in there as well. But it does need development from the manufacturers. I think something that might boost it, dare I say it, is maybe something like a Dtools plugin, which we've been discussing, and there are several different layers of BIM, and there's 2D, 3D, 4D, 5 up to 6D. Is that right? And the quotation plugin comes in at about 5D. Is that right, or 4D? About 5D. So you know, it needs someone with a huge library who's bringing people in quickly and effectively to give this a real boost. Yeah.
Just another thing on that, these websites or these companies that are helping people model their objects, they are doing it to a standard, the National Building Specification Standards, that they have a set of parameters that tell them what to put in there so that the objects are getting consistency in that data. Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you.